Good morning, students. Today we are going to continue with next part of the chapter Socialism in Europe and the Russian Revolution. Now this is the part which tells about Stalin and his rule. After the Lenin, after his death, till 1924, the Bolsheviks was under the rule of Lenin. After his death, this party was taken over by Joseph Stalin. There was, during his reign or his rule, there was acute shortage of grain in 1927. The government had fixed the price for the grains, but the peasants did not want to sell to the government at these prices. When there is shortage of grains in the country, Stalin had fixed the prices of grains, but there were so many farmers who were not willing to sell to the government at these prices. At that time, the rich peasants, who were also called as kulaks in Russia, they were raided and grain stocks confiscated. That is, the rich peasants who were called as kulaks, they were raided. The government started raiding them. That means going to them suddenly and then taking over their grains. And the grains were taken over by the government. Stalin also enforced a system of farming which is called as collectivization as solution to the grains shortage. So Stalin introduced a system of farming known as collectivization, where many farmers will together cultivate the lands. That means removal of the fences. The fences will be removed and the whole land, suppose every farmer is having 5 hectares of land. So, now suppose there are 5 farmers, they will remove the fences, so the land now will become 25 hectares. So, now the farmers will together work upon this 25 hectares of land and will share the profit and loss. So, this kind of system was developed by Stalin, thinking that there will be increase in the production of grains. Peasants were forced to work in collective farms. And what were the collective farms were called as? They were called as kolkhoz. Many peasants were not willing to work under these collective farms because no farmer would like to give away his land and work collectively. So there were many farmers who were forced to do so that they can share their profit equally. But this was not entirely successful. This collectivization was not so successful, as the production of grain did not increase immediately. Because to increase the production of grains, it takes a lot of time. So suddenly, even if you do collectivization, it could not increase the production immediately. And more worse condition had developed in Soviet Union. That is, in 1930, Soviet Union faced one of the worst famines in history, where near about 4 million people died. So, what are the conditions or uses? You can talk about the merits and demerits of this kind of system. So I'm repeating quickly about the Stalinism and collectivization, children. Now, that actually it means state controlled in large farms. Collectivization means where the state will have whole control on these large farms. In 1927-28, in Soviet Russia, were facing acute problem of grain supplies. Government fixed the prices at which farmers had to sell their grains. But as I said, farmers refused to sell their grains to government because the prices fixed were very low. So many farmers denied this. After the death of Lenin, Stalin heads the Bolshevik Party. He introduced emergency measures. He believed that the rich peasants and traders were engaged in hoarding. He, according to Stalin, the rich farmers, the rich merchants and the rich farmers have kept their grains hoarding. Hoarding means chupa ke rakhna, jisko aap kehte ho. So hoarding, it was hoarded. And when Stalin came to know, he sent his men and forcefully the grains were taken off. Confiscated means taken under the control of the government. That happened in 1928. Stalin also started collectivization. He believed grain shortage was due to small size of the lands. According to Stalin, the grains are shortage in the country because the farms are very small. So, these small sized farms which farmers got in 1917 could not be modernized and there was no modernization in these farms. So, he said it was necessary to eliminate these kulaks, that is the large farmers, to develop modern farms with the use of machines. So he wanted, like in India, children, we studied removal of Jamindari system and giving the lands to the peasants. But the here difference is removing the large farmers called as kulaks and taking the land under the control of the government. And also removing and also taking the lands from the small peasants and asking the peasants to work collectively. That is what Stalin introduced. So, the land was taken away from the peasants and they were forced to cultivate in collective farms. Farmers, land and implements were transferred to the ownership of the collective farms. Who were the owner of the farms? Earlier, if a farmer had 2 hectares of land, now he had to give away the 2 hectares of land to whom? To the government. So, the farmers will work on that, but the land will belong to the government. And the peasants worked in the farms and profit was shared. But some angry peasants resisted authorities and destroyed their livestock. Many peasants were not happy to work under this collectivization where their lands will be under the government. So many of the angry peasants, what did they do? They have destroyed their livestock. So number of cattle fell by 1/3. Because they never wanted to give it to the government. So they themselves destroyed their cattle. So the cattle fell by, number of cattle fell by 1/3 in the country. But those who did this, they were severely punished by the government. And they were removed from the country. They were sent out of the Soviet Union. They said they were not rich and not against socialism. They had their own reason to object collectivization. What did these farmers said? Why did they do so? Why did they kill their cattle? The farmers said they were not against the rich. They were not so rich, first of all, and they were not against the socialism. But they had their own reason to object this kind of collectivization. They don't want to give it to the government. In spite of all the collectivization methods, production did not increase. Stalin did all the methods but could not increase the production much. Rather, by 1930 and 33, there were 4 million people died because of the famine in the country. Those who criticized the collectivization program were charged with conspiracy against socialism. There were many people who were against this collectivization. They were punished severely because, according to Stalin, they were against the socialism. By 1939, over 2 million critics were sent to prison and the labor camps. That means they were killed. By 1939, all those who were against the Stalin's collectivization, they were sent to prison or the concentration camps. Many were innocent also, but had more to speak for them. Many were forced to make false confessions. Many were forced to confess under the torture, and so later they were executed. Many of them were also talented professionals who were against Stalin and his method of collectivization. All of them were killed. So that's about your Stalinism and collectivization. In one way, children, we completed the complete part of the socialism and the Russian Revolution, because now we are heading towards another topic, that is global influence of Russian Revolution. That is, what was the impact of this Russian Revolution? How, what influence it had upon the whole world? Existing socialist parties in Europe did not wholly approve of the way the Bolshevik captured power, still kept it. But the possibility of a worker state fired people's imagination across the world. Communist parties were formed in many countries. So in many countries, communist parties were formed. Many non-Russians from outside the USSR participated in the conference of the people of the East, Bolshevik founded Comintern. These Bolsheviks, supported by several people of the world who believed in socialism. So together, these Bolsheviks formed a larger worldwide international party, which is called as Comintern. What is Comintern? It is an international union of the people who supported Bolshevik socialist parties. So who supported them? Many non-Russians from outside USSR. They participated and they supported Bolsheviks and the Socialist Party. During the outbreak of the Second World War, USSR had given socialism a global face. During the Second World War, that is from 1939 to 1945, this kind of socialism had spread to many parts of the world. People had a lot of faith on this kind of socialism. So the USSR had given socialism a global face. That is, it became popular all over the world. And the style of government in USSR not keeping with the ideals of Russian Revolution. But there is one thing lacking in the style of government in USSR. They fought for the workers, they fought for the equal rights of the peasants and the equality in the society. But actually, the socialism or the communist party government did not give equal economic rights to the people. They failed in this. They although fought, their revolution was for this, for the workers, their revolution was for the equality of the people, economic equality, social equality, but they failed in many of the spheres. Though its industries and agriculture had developed and poor were being fed, few things they did were, we can call them as the merits of socialism. So there were some merits and there were some demerits also of this socialism in Russia. So, industries and agriculture had developed because of socialism, and poor were really fed. The essential freedom of to its citizens was being denied. But the actual freedom to the citizens was not given to the people. It was recognized that social ideals still enjoyed respect among the few people only. So, the socialism, the meaning socialism means socially equal, economically equal, politically equal. But this kind of socialism has given some benefits to the poor, but not completely. The favorism was not done completely. There were still few things which the USSR government had failed to recognize. But still, the people of Russia, that is the Bolsheviks and the socialists, still enjoyed a respect, a lot of respect among the Russians. Now let's do a few of the terms, then again we'll come back to the influence. Communism. Russia was the first country to establish a communist state. Soon after the revolution, Communist International, that is Comintern, was formed for promoting revolutions on an international scale. Just now, as we discussed, a Comintern international organization called as Comintern was formed, so that what is the role of this organization? They will promote the revolutions, any kind of revolutions they will promote. So in the same manner, for example, in Russia, they had revolution. That kind of revolutions had spread to the countries like India also. So once Russia had removed the monarchy and the socialism state was set up there, they also supported many countries of the world to remove imperialist form of governments. And they also supported many countries of the world to get their independence. Like they supported India to get independence from British rule. So the revolutions led to the formation of communist parties in many countries. Socialism. Despite differences between the communist and the socialist, after the revolution, socialism became one of the widely held ideologies. Popularity of socialism helped mitigate discrimination based on race, color, and sex. There was, when the socialism had spread in the world, it had really removed a lot of discriminations based on race, color, and sex. Democracy. The revolution led to the redefinition of democracy. Most people began to recognize that for democracy to be real, political rights without social and economic rights were not enough. These revolutionaries, they said, they had actually recognized the meaning of democracy. They said, only giving the political rights is not enough. If the people don't get social and economic rights, giving political rights is of no use. That is what they said. So that is true also. Giving just the political right is of no use. They should be given even the economic and social rights also. Then only it is of some use. So let's proceed to the next slide. That tells about few more terms like economic planning, the idea of state playing an active role in regulating the economy and planning the economy to improve the conditions of the people gained wide acceptance. In Russia, the way the Stalin and Lenin had done, everything was under the control of the government. So the idea of this kind of state or the government playing important role so that the economy can be regulated, there can be a proper development of the economy and also to improve the conditions of the people. Dignity of labor. He that does not work, neither shall he eat. Now the labor in the world, not only in Russia, their work is being recognized, because the person who doesn't work doesn't have the right to eat. That gained wide acceptance, adding a new dignity to labor. So any kind of labor, whatever work you do, that is dignified, that is respectable. Maybe you are a farmer, maybe you are just a small labor at a construction site. Any work, that is dignified. Internationalism. Socialist ideas also helped in promoting internationalism by emphasizing nations think beyond narrow self-interest. So the meaning of internationalism, that is socialism, socialists believed that the idea should not only restrict only to their country, it should spread to the world also. Then imperialism. We all know what is imperialism. Many European countries ruled over the other countries. That's your imperialism. So the Russian Revolution also happened to end this imperialism. They supported many countries to end this imperialism. For example, they supported India to gain independence from several countries who were dominating the other countries. Like as I told you, in India, they helped India also. In the same way, they helped many countries of the world to gain independence. That is also one reason that after the Second World War, there was a Cold War between Russia and America. Because by doing all this, Russia had spread their form of government, that is the communist form of government, to other countries. Many countries became following, many countries started following the Russian style of governance, that is the communist form of government. So their power also increased. Many Eastern European countries started following Russian form of government, due to which America was against this, the increased power of Russia. So there was a time after the Second World War when the Europe lost its power in the world, and it was America and Russia who became the most powerful countries of the world. And there was a Cold War between them because they too became the more powerful. America wanted their style of government to spread in the world, and Russia was spreading its style of government in the world. So that made the difference between the two countries, and there was a Cold War between the two. And then we come to the last slide here. That is your terms like nationalism. We all know this. We study nationalism. That is, when in India, when Britishers ruled, the people of India fought for their rights. That is nationalism, feeling of nationalism, that we belong to this country and it's our country. No foreign country can rule upon us. The revolution awakened, the revolution in Russia awakened the people. It has inspired the people of Asia, people of Africa, and also infused a new spirit. And it had given a new spirit of nationalism to fight for our independence from the colonialism. When Britishers ruled India, so India was a colony for Britishers. It is called as colonization. In 8th class, you might have studied. So we fought for our country, and we got this inspiration from the Russian Revolution, division of the world. Now, as I told you just now, the whole world came to be divided into two after the Second World War, that is after 1945. Earlier, it was the Europe which was very, very powerful. Now, that is Germany, Britain, France, they were very powerful countries of the world. And that's after the First and Second World War. Their power declined, and it was the two powers which had given rise after the Second World War, that is the America and Russia. America followed a system called as capitalist form of government. Capitalist means capital, money. That is, those who had lot of money, the rich people's rule is called as capitalism. So America followed capitalist form of government, and America wanted the world to follow this form of government. Even Britain, France followed capitalist form of government. But Russia followed socialist form of government. Socialist means equal, where all the people are equal. So the revolution gave a call to the workers of the world to unite against the capitalist. Socialism in Russia, it had given an opportunity to the workers of the world to get united and fight against this form of capitalist form of government. That is, the owners of the industries, the rich people will rule the country. So the workers of the world were against this form of government. It is all because of the Russian Revolution. It is all because of the spread of socialism in Russia. Though by the end of the 20th century, the international reputation of USSR as a social country is declined. Slowly, the USSR's power started declining because their form of government, that is socialist form of government, which says that the people should be given equal economic, equal political, equal social rights, that was not given under the socialist form of government. They formed the government. They had to coin the term of socialism, but they did not follow the true socialist form of government, due to which their popularity started declining. But still, the ideals of the Russian Revolution enjoy respect in among the people of the world. So just let me tell you the benefits of influence of Russian Revolution. The backward country like Russia had become a great power because of Russian Revolution. Industries and agriculture developed in the Russia. Poor were being fed in Russia. Those who lived in the background like workers for ages, they came forward in the open. They were illiterate. The farmers were illiterate, helpless, hungry earlier. But after the Russian Revolution, all the people, they became more powerful. The movement of helplessness and ignorance through this revolution, they formed their own parties, their own unions under the Russian Revolution. And the demerits were, the Russian Revolution, it was formed for spreading socialism, but it had denied the essential freedom to its citizens. Although they formed the socialist form of government, they did not give all the freedom to the citizens. It carried out its development projects through repressive policies. Like under the Stalin, we have seen, they forced the people to work so that the country can develop. Repressive policies means forceful development, forcefully making the people to work. By the end of 20th century, the international reputation of USSR as a socialist country had declined. Their power had declined because they were actually, they bought, according to socialism, it should give all these rights to the people, but that were not given to the people. So that is how they lost some kind of popularity in the country. In India, what is the influence of Russian Revolution in India? Indians were inspired because at that time we were ruled by Britishers. So we fought against the Britishers by getting inspired from this Russian Revolution. Many workers in India, they revolted against the owners of the industries. Many farmers in India, the poor farmers, revolted against the Jamindars because they were inspired from this socialism. For example, some of the Indians visited even the Russia for this purpose, like Jawaharlal Nehru, Rabindranath Tagore. R.S. Awasthi, he wrote Russian Revolution, Lenin, his life and his thoughts, and the Red Revolution. A person called as Vidya Lankar wrote The Rebirth of Russia and the Soviet State of Russia. Shaukat Usman wrote Historic Trips of a Revolutionary Russia. And many writers wrote a lot of things in about Russian Revolution in many languages, Bengali, Marathi, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu, so that the local people can get inspired from this revolution, Russian Revolution, and stand together against the Britishers. So that's how the Russian Revolution and children, and two or three keywords I'm telling you. Bolsheviks means one of the majority party. It stands for Majorist Party of Russia. Duma, Labor House of Russian Parliament. Duma means to think. It's a word coming from Dumat, that is to think. Then Tsar, from Latin word Caesar, which means emperor. So these are the few terms which we have come across the chapter, and that completes chapter. Children, do watch all the videos again to better understand this Russian Revolution. That's all, children. Have a good day. I hope you have followed the chapter thoroughly.